Welcome everyone to the latest episode of PodCastle in the Sky. This episode we're looking at two pieces of fantasy schlock with 1982's The Sword and the Sorcerer and 1996's OBA anime Garzey's Wing. My name is Tom.
I'm Amber.
I am Jesse.
And this is William.
Okay, so normally we start off each episode by summarizing the plot of what we're covering. But it's actually pretty damn hard this time because the plot for both things is all over the place. I mean, okay, let's start with the anime, Garzey's Wing. It's about this guy in Japan who may or may not be half American, and he is sucked into another world, a fantasy world, and he has to help slaves rebel against an evil empire, I think. And then he's also connected to his body back in Japan because his spirit is in this fantasy world and his body is in Japan or something. And then he fights and he's like a destined savior or something. It is really hard to figure out what the hell is going on in Garzey's Wing. And like half the things in there are actually not important in the story. They're completely extraneous. And that's pretty much the same thing for the Sword and the Sorcerer. I mean, okay, so there's this prince, exiled prince. His kingdom has been conquered by this one warlord. And, okay, that's pretty simple. He comes back. You would think so, right? But no. He doesn't come back to get back his kingdom. He comes back to get someone else's kingdom back for them. And there's like a demon wizard, and there's nudity.
Because it's the 80s.
Fortitudes.
Yes.
And everywhere.
There was an entire hour where there was no nudity, and I was really surprised. I was like, wow, how could a movie this awful not have nudity?
They made you wait. They made you wait.
Exactly.
But Jesus.
I was actually surprised because it was so dumb. I really thought it was being aimed at young children.
Oh, really?
Oh, no.
Oh no. I assumed
we can talk.
I assumed it wasn't aimed at young children, but I was also surprised that it took so long to get to the nudity and felt real bad for all those teenage boys in the 80s who were like, where are the tits? Man, where are the fucking tits? I just want to see.
Yeah, subsequent like low, which it tells you a lot about this whole genre, of which I have watched a number for God knows what reason. The rest of them, its successors, are like, all right, we're gonna put the tits in like the first 30 seconds of the movie. You know where you're getting them, all right? Some swords and some titties. Ah. But this one pretends to be a real movie for a little while. It has, you know, an old man with ridiculous beards giving... I started laughing during the opening narration of The Sword and the Sorcerer because I kept thinking of the Stonehenge speech from This is Spinal Tap. Like, even the man's voice is eerily similar. And it was just like, all right, this is some grade-A schlock. I'm ready. I'm ready for this.
It was really kind of classically schlocky. I actually enjoyed the movie on that kind of level where it was, like, delicious schlock, you know, with all the shitty jokes and the ridiculous sword fights. And, actually, I did have a comment. Did anybody else notice for it being named The Sword and the Sorcerer, it had an incredibly small amount of either? Like, we see the magic sword, like, twice. Once at the beginning of the film, once at the end. And we see the sorcerer. I mean, we know that the sorcerer, like, was undercover the whole time. But at the same time, it was like, he shows up, gets stabbed off of a cliff or whatever.
Yeah, so the plot here... As Jesse was saying, the plot is, it's both incredibly simplistic and incoherent at the same time, which is the same with Garzey's Wing. I don't know how these movies manage this. It's both incredibly dumb and convoluted simultaneously, but so at the start of the movie, the evil king, he raises this devil sorcerer guy in a scene that's actually quite neat, and so he makes a deal with the devil sorcerer dude to take over the good kingdom, and then unceremoniously stabs this guy as he throws him off a cliff or whatever. Really not the best executed execution of an incredibly powerful demon lord, but such a life. And so, yeah, there's all these elements at play. And I think, I kind of wonder, I'd love to know the time when, in terms of this was produced, because this is 82, 83. Conan, which is Conan the Barbarian, the adaptation, the film adaptation in 82 is like what kicked off all these movies. And so this comes out right after it. And it sort of has the same structure. It's this like weird Shaggy Dog thing where there's technically a revenge plot in Conan the Barbarian that drives the plot. And so I guess this is sort of just fantasy schlock in general. There's like this Shaggy Dog main plot that's ostensibly driving the character somewhere. But in between, it's like you're playing a D&D game or like an RPG. Like you get, there's all these weird little tangents you go off of. It's like, oh, we need to go to the bar and sex up the wenches. We need to save this. And it's like, it needs to take you on an adventure. And the way that it takes you on an adventure is just like, we're going to do random shit for no reason. And that's pretty much how all of these movies are structured, for whatever reason.
Okay, I thought it was pretty hilarious that they had Talon, our, you know, secret prince, you know, driven off of the throne and all. And he comes back and he's just like, you know, a barbarian mercenary now and has no desire to be back. Like, he helps the other guy get to the throne. But I thought it really was, I thought it was going to be his story, but it really wasn't.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, yeah, it's like, I want to know what the writing process on this movie was like, because again, they set up this, you know, the main character is the son of the ousted king, and so you think, oh, he's going to reclaim his throne and all that. But yeah, and then it's like 10 years later, he's a wandering mercenary, i.e. he's exactly like Conan the Barbarian. This definitely isn't right Conan the Barbarian, everybody. Don't worry about it. And then, yeah, and so he just kind of like wanders around killing dudes for kicks because he's just such a badass with his, also he has a sword of 3 blades.
Okay.
Which doesn't look stupid at all. And
explain how the sword works.
And then, so there's the center blade, which is like the normal sword blade, and then the 2 outer blades you shoot off like it's a fucking, what's that, Final Fantasy VIII where he can shoot off the blades on his gun? And they blow
the
their
gun
load
blade.
Yeah, the gun blade. They blow their load on that one right at the start, and then never use it again for like pretty much the entire movie.
In fact, he shoots one at the end, and then he shoots it away like to make the second one like to make the fight fair or some shit.
Oh, that's right.
And I was like, you have a gun blade. You have a blade and like a sad like egg slicer sword.
Yeah, they're like, he needs an awesome shtick. Give him a shtick. It's such like with all these movies, but especially with the sword, it's very much, it's like 10-year-old logic. Like, you know what's awesome? Swords. You know what would be awesomer? A sword with 8 blades. Wow! 8 blades.
I think you can see where I thought this was for children, you know, at first. I mean, when you're talking about the different elements of the film, the opening part of the film, the simplistic fantasy story with the good kingdom and the bad kingdom and the sword and the evil monster, it's like Chronicles of Prydain or the Black Cauldron or something. But that's actually the same thing. I've never read Chronicles of Prydain. I just assume it's like that. I'm sure there's very offended fans of that right now. Just this kind of elemental fantasy story, good, evil. Maybe it was like some guy's dream thing he'd scrawled in the 70s while reading a lot of Kurt Wagner or something. Or, sorry, it should be Kurt Wagner, shouldn't it? What's the name of that guy? Kane the something or other?
Yeah, I know what you're talking about, but yeah. I can't remember.
I'm basically just referencing an obscure 70s kind of Conan knockoff character, for those who don't know what I'm talking about.
Well, for sword and sorcery, I mean, you would expect there to be good swordplay, but the action is kind of lackluster. I call it the John Wayne Star Trek style of fighting, where... like, you know, it's like you're looking at it and it's like, what the hell? I could do that. Why am I watching some out of shape guys going at each other?
Yeah, it's not particularly impressive.
When I was watching it, my mind kept wandering. I was like, I kept remembering fights from Jackie Chan movies and so on. And I was like, oh yeah, I'm watching this movie. I suddenly remembered.
I like that your brain, like, inserted good fight scenes as, like, a holder while you got through the bad ones. Like, let's just wander over here for a second. Let's just think about the one for a moment. Not, I mean, that's Jet Li, but you know what I mean. Like,
yeah, no, it's just like these uncoordinated large men just, like, bonking each other with things. Which is, it's kind of the movie in a microcosm. It's just large men bonking each other. I mean, even the name, the whole entire genre, Sword and Sorcery, we have a movie literally called The Sword and the Sorcerer. It's like, we have taken elements that were already generic, and we have genericized them further. It's an impressive feat in some ways to make something this generic. On the opposite side, you have Garzey's Wing, which is the most incoherent bullshit. I don't know if it's translation, but I'd watched like the gag reel of Garzey's Wing before, like a lot of people. It's infamous.
To credit that, by the way, that was made by Justin Savakis for his article on Garzey's Wing, which you can get at Anime News Network, which is fantastic.
I highly recommend it. Buried garbage.
Garzey's Wing. Well worth a look. Continue.
You know, so I had watched that gag reel, and there are a bunch of scenes in that, you know, where they're in modern day and stuff. And so I expected, like, the first maybe 15 or 20 minutes of the movie was going to be set up for getting this guy from the modern day to this other world. But it's within maybe 2 minutes of the movie starting. He's like, I'm on my motorcycle. Oh, my God, my sacred amulet is shaking. Could it be this? Ah! And then it's literally within 2 minutes. Nothing is explained, and he gets thrown into this other dimension. I'm like, what is this fucking garbage?
Oh my God,
and all the characters are like, it's Garzey's Wing, the spirit of Shakatomikato.
Literally
Garzey's Wing. Oh my God. Yeah, no, like the way they were pronouncing the Japanese names, they clearly it was just gibberish to them. And actually, there is one quote from the main character that I almost hurt myself laughing when he said this. He says, there's two of them, right? One of them is in Japan, one of them is in the fantasy world.
Yeah,
they're
yes.
communicating telepathically. And he says
through their weirdly shaking necklace.
And he says to the other guy, who's also himself, I must somehow make sense of our convoluted situation.
That entire scene is my favorite part of the whole thing. And I think it also probably shows the ways that translation errors are a problem, because he talks about even there are 13th century and 14th century foreigners or something like that. A sentence that makes absolutely no sense in English. I can only feel like it was a literal translation of some Japanese word which means something to that effect. There's kind of an interesting backstory to Garzey's Wing involving its creator, Yoshiyuki Tamino, who's better known as creator of Gundam. So back in the early 1980s, he just created Gundam, which was a huge hit, and he wanted to do a fantasy series. And he was allowed to do a fantasy series. It just had to have giant robots because, you know, they have to sell toys. And he didn't like that, but he put the robots in anyway. And the result was Aura Battler Dunbine, which was also a hit. And it kind of started the trend of giant robots in fantasy. In fact, while listeners may have never seen Aura Battler Dunbine, many of them may have seen an anime directly inspired by it, Visions of Escaflowne.
Oh, yeah.
Which is kind of a shoujo take on Aura Battler Dunbine. You know, same idea. You know, someone transported to a fantasy world with all this kind of fantasy conflict and these big kind of weird-looking robots. Tamino really wanted to do a version of the story with no robots. And then the big OVA boom, the 1990s. You know, he's still a big guy. He's done a lot of hits. He's in movies. He's in other Gundams. And he finally gets to tell a story. And this is actually in the same continuity as the Bryston's Well continuity of Aura Battler Dunbine. You might be thinking, well, if you've seen Aura Battler Dunbine, this makes more sense, right? You have more of an idea of what's going on. But that might be something occurring to people. I've seen Aura Battler Dunbine. You know, if you have a taste for like early 80s mecha cartoons, it's pretty good. But I have absolutely no idea what's going on in Garzey's Wing. It did not help one bit.
It's completely incoherent.
You know that subtitle, the Bison Well story?
Yeah. That's the setting of Aura Battler Dunbine. This is the same fantasy world.
Yeah. So I assume this was an adaptation of like a fantasy novel series or something, and that's why it didn't make any sense, because they were trying to cram too much of the book into the series. But then I looked into it, and no, there is no fantasy novel series. It's doesn't make sense because that's how they made it. They made it make no sense.
I was kind of astounded about... I watched the dub just because I had heard it is funnier that way. But it can't possibly have just been the dub, because the writing itself, the plot, just made no fucking sense.
Not only do they have no setup before this guy on his motorcycle gets turned into a bird person, but literally like 30 seconds after he lands, they're like, we are the Mamatamagata tribe, and we are one of 8,000 tribes these tribes are fighting these tribes. It's like, why? Who fucking cares? What? None of this means anything. Like, why? Why? There's so many questions I have. It's not actually a complicated story. Like, bad people are doing bad things. Good tribe is doing good things. Space Earthman goes to help them. Like, that's all you need. But immediately, once he gets into the world, they start... And they're in the middle of combat, too, which makes it even funnier. And they're explaining the entire structure of this world and all the tribes in it. It's like, this is total nonsense. Listen. It reminds me... Did any of you play Final Fantasy 13? It reminds me of that, where they, like, clearly created all this lore, and it has all these stupid terms that if you didn't read, like, how the world was structured beforehand, it's all just garbage gibberish. But they're like, fuck that, I don't have to explain anything. And they just start dumping all these stupid, lalacy, falsy. They just start dumping all the terms they created into the first 10 minutes of the story, and you're just like, this is just nonsense. Utter nonsense.
Listen, Tom, the writers are just human, you know, and humans are just human.
Okay. All right, so does this gobbledygook sound reasonable and not stupid in Japanese? Because it's like, okay, here, I wrote down a list of their gibberish. It's Duragaro, Gabu Juju, Ashigaba, Baraju Tree. I was like, what the hell? I mean, fantasy stories, they do have a tendency to be nothing but stupid nonsense words over and over and over. But there's a way to do it without, you know, making it sound like meaningless gibberish.
Right. Yeah, the way you do that is to set it up or, like, space it out. I don't know if maybe, you know, he had these big ambitions and he had this world and he wanted to create a Gundam-style thing that was, you know, 50 episodes or something, and in which case it would be fine. Because there are elements of the world that are kind of fun if you take all the stupid words away. Like, there's dudes fighting on fucking dinosaurs. I can get on board with that. Sounds fun, if it made any sense. You know, do fucking knights on pterodactyls? I'll take that shit. But I want to know what's going on.
Well, I know what's not the problem is the budget, because... Just from the animation alone, you can tell that they had a pretty decent budget. I mean, look at the dinosaurs, look at the pterodactyls, look at the horses. If you've never drawn a horse, you have no idea how hard it is to draw a horse. And they have like dozens of horses all over there. So it's not about the money, it's just about the way they use that money to write the story.
Yeah, that was one of the things that surprised me. Because, you know, Sword and the Sorcerer, and basically all the 80s fantasy movies, except for, like, Excalibur, which is weird. It's like a prestige fantasy movie. Pretty much all the other ones are really... They're straddling the line on B-movies. And so, you know, we talked about the fight scenes in Sword and Sorcerer are pretty clumsy. You know, these were not really, like, prestigious pictures. They're kind of, this is the trend. We're going to make a fantasy movie, and we're going to get some C-list stars, and they're going to beat each other up. It's, like, charmingly kind of shaky around the edges or in the center at sometimes. Whereas this, as incoherent as this is, it looks really nice. It looks really good. It's well animated. There's something here. They could have made something good. Although, then we would be denied of this wonderful dub, which just made me laugh harder than any comedy has in many years. So, really, it's a blessing that they made this. Thanks. Thanks, Tomio.
I don't want to, you know, keep going back to this particular article, but there's an interesting part in the Buried Garbage article I mentioned about Garzey's wing. Savakis worked for Central Park Entertainment, which at one point had licensed that, and he was at a thing with Yoshiyuki Tomino, and it was the only Tomino work they'd licensed. So the entire team were just peppering him and his translator with questions to the effect of what went wrong. And the only response they got from Tomino was, I don't want to talk about it. So... Now, a thesis often presented is it's really the issue is Tomino himself to some extent, that the incoherence of the writing is, you know, him. So this is kind of his Phantom Menace or something. I think, like, even if you look at the best things he's involved in with, let's say, Zeta Gundam, for example, the dialogue never feels particularly organic. There's just more interesting developments and characters and plots and all those things.
Yeah, I think it's probably just the time element. He's made really great stuff, obviously. He's extremely significant, but he does have these flaws. And it's less of a problem in a series where you have the time to sort of develop all the more interesting stuff. Whereas in a little OVA like this, all those bad habits are just in this condensed space. You can't avoid it. It is there.
I mean, it wasn't his first work, so you'd think we would have gotten some idea of how to do it. So, I don't know, there must be some weird backstory to this.
Yeah, we'll never know, I guess. But I think it's probably maybe like William was saying that, you know, he'd been wanting to do this with this world for a while, and this was his chance. It was just too much. It was just too much. Too many ideas, not enough. Like, someone to step in and be like, you know, like, yeah, I mean, Phantom Menace might not be a bad comparison. You need someone to step in and be like, hey, maybe cut out this, cut out that, do a little trimming, little editing on the edges. You know, yeah, if someone without editorial intervention can get, much as we like the brilliant lone artist, sometimes an editor is a good thing.
Maybe explain why a leap year is significant, because they kept saying that over and over. How can he do this? It's a leap year.
Well, dude, like, not even just, there's even just moments, like, I specifically pointed out the moment when to get the gunpowder onto the arrow, the fairy girl offers up her oily wing roots. It's just even weird shit like that, like...
Yeah,
was that a necessary thing? Why not just have some resin around? Was that not something that people fighting a war with peace? Like,
you don't want lore? Get out. You're getting all the lore.
You're getting all the lore. And what I'm learning right now is that fairies, oily wing roots, guys. I assume that they treat that shit with, like, some talcum powder or something. I don't know.
Also, this is a stupid, purely aesthetic complaint, but Garzey's wing, it's literal wings that this guy has. I gave him special powers or something, I guess. But so the wings come out of his ankles, and it looks so goddamn stupid. I know it's more generic to have them come out of his back, but come on, guys. Wings coming out of your ankles, you look like a big old dork. Big old dork.
I guess he was supposed to be like Mercury, but yeah, it looks stupid.
It's pretty
and
jerky.
Yeah. and it's a shame because, you know, there's wings on the Dunbines, the robots in Aura Battler Dunbine, and they actually look pretty cool. They're insect wings, and they come out of, you know, like the back of your body, like the fairies. It's a really neat design.
Are their roots properly oiled?
Not that I recall. I don't recall. I mean, it would make a lot more sense for properly oiled roots in a giant robot. but if that ever came up on the show, I've not seen it in like 10 years or something, so I don't remember, to be honest.
Okay,
it's really a masterpiece of just everything going wrong, except the animation.
Well, yeah, the animation was surprisingly good for something.
Well, that's the thing. It's
I was honestly expecting something way more out of whack, you know, like the characters not staying on point. What do you call it when everything gets off kilter? Like the...
I know what you mean.
There's a particular word for that, when, like, a character loses its shape suddenly, or...
It was in my mind, like, 30 seconds ago. And then...
Yeah.
I think the word is Berserk 2017. Topical reference.
R.I.P. Berserk.
I was expecting it to be more like Fist of the North Star, but...
Yeah!
Well, it's weird. It's like watching a terrible B-movie. It's like Universal Soldier, The Return, except it was given a AAA Hollywood budget, and it's very confusing. Normally... schlock is schlock, and good things are good, but this is somehow both at once. You don't see these kind of disasters much. Honestly, it's a great thing to watch, this movie. It's such a disaster, but in such an entertaining way.
I don't know, it's fascinating. Like, someone, probably more than one person, poured their hearts out into this, and they gave 110%, and they produced this.
Well, you know, it's been immortalized for a different reason. So there's that, I suppose.
But actually, you know what? We barely covered the dubbing. And I got to say, most of the dubbing, it sounds like five people in an empty room. It's really friggin' awful. So if you're ever watching this, watch the English dub version.
Did anybody else just write down favorite lines? Because I totally did. Like,
I don't think anything can top that strangely self-aware line about the convoluted plot.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, I started to catalog favorite lines just mentally, but there ended up being so many of them that I gave up. Yeah. I can't emphasize enough. Because if you took away the dub, this movie would be stupid, but maybe not. It wouldn't be that laughable. Stupid.
Yeah.
But the dub is such a work of unintentional art. Like, every single line is just so confused and inhuman in a way that interacts with what's happening in just the perfect way. You couldn't possibly make it this funny, like, on purpose. It's really quite beautiful, if I may.
I have, like, just two lines, because for me it was the inflection that the voice actor was putting on it that just killed me. And one was where he was given a sword and it says, "This is heavier than a damn Japanese sword." The other one was, he was being asked by someone if he wanted to stay in this world, or like if he likes this world or something, and he said, "If you had a convenience store, then I would live with you." And I was like, oh god,
right. It's like they're not even, it's like they don't even know English.
No.
Or Japanese. It's just like total confusion about what words mean. And there's a fun line, it's in the first like 5 minutes of the movie, and they're running away and they're like, "Now the other tribes are retreating, therefore we will also escape into the forest with the other tribes." And then the main character is like, "How many people are there?" And then the woman runs over and she's like, there are at least 1,000 or so running into the forest. It's like, "Oh, you're supposed to be afraid? There's a fucking dinosaur." Like, it's just every single thing is so absurd. Which I guess is, you know, this was the boom, and quality was not king at the time. So
I think I read the same Anime News Network article as Will, because there's actually a line there about the dubbing. That article, it mentions that the dubbing was done by a company from Staten Island, an area of New York known for its landfills, which holy crap, what a burn, Staten Island.
Beautiful line of the written word. I love it.
Honestly, a shame there's no like obvious New York stereotypes here, because that would have been hilarious. My favorite lines, though, are pretty much all concentrated in the one scene where he's talking to himself, his other self, for the first time, because every single thing he says in that is hilarious. You know, like, "I am naked. Even dinosaurs are here. If you die over there, do I die here? Probably." "I must do chi.
Chi unification."
Yes.
I also want to
spiritual enlightenment. Chi unification.
I also want to point out, it also completely goes against the continuity of what they'd had until that moment, because as completely incoherent as the film was, you clearly follow the guy being pulled in by the duck. As only subsequently revealed, there's a different version of him who's still back there and he can talk to, but is also living his life. And they're, what?
You're right, and again,
this is not what the first Bison Weld thing did. This is not what Dumbine did. The guy's just pulled into a fantasy world, and, you know, that's it. You know.
Yeah, right. I didn't really get the.
And it serves no narrative purpose.
Yeah, it doesn't.
There's like no real payoff. It just is. It's like just there.
The only thing is that he could die in one world, and it'll kill them both or something. Maybe,
so,
I don't know.
So if he gets hit by a Japanese truck, then he dies. You know, it's like, what is the extra payoff here?
I have a theory about that, actually, and it's about the whole plan to have like a giant series about it, because I think it was related to this whole gunpowder thing, where the guy in Japan is coming up with ideas to use in a fantasy world. Because there's like this sub-genre of fantasy where someone time travels or travels to a fantasy land and they use their giant brains and their knowledge of modern science to rule the land or something. And I think that's where it was supposed to go if the series was longer.
Oh yeah, that's right, because the him that's in the modern day and his buddies, because everybody, you know, you tell your buds that half of your soul is trapped in some fantasy land, they get you, they know, they know who you are, you know, and they help you tell your past person stuck in the past self how to produce flares and shit.
Should we be telling Jim, who thinks he's in a fantasy realm, how to make advanced weapons?
Let's just humor him for now.
This is gonna be okay.
Goes.
You're not going to, like, you light your boss's house on fire or anything. No, it's fine, dude. I'm fighting dragons.
I'm fighting dragons. This is totally normal. Yeah.
Christ.
I love that his girlfriend is just, like, you know, down with this now. It's like holding his hand and giving him her power or whatever the fuck that means.
Exactly. Like, he's suddenly, like, some kind of energy vampire or something.
I loved that creepy scene where, like, she gets out of bed and she goes up to his room and then his mother watches her do it and it's like, what was that? What was the tiniest side? What does that even mean? Like, mom's like, yeah, you go up there and help my son who is, I don't know.
There's endless questions. You could really never stop asking questions about this movie.
So many questions. No answers.
It's a fucking matryoshka of just confusion. You can never get to the center.
Well, I mean, okay, so we did mention one good thing about Garzey Swings, the animation. But yeah, can we mention one good thing about the Sword and the Sorcerer? One thing that they deliberately did, not accidentally.
Oh, actually, I can. I can mention one scene that I legitimately enjoyed for its own merits, and that was when the pirates and the mercenaries find out that Talon had been kidnapped. And they're all in a whorehouse, and they all band together, and they are like, hey, I'll get my guys. Hey, I'll get my guys. And they're all making plans, and everybody goes, yeah! Cut to all of them in cells.
That was pretty good. Yeah, he's not actually in the movie very much, but the stuff with the sorcerer is actually cool in a very, again, pulpy fantasy way, which
the practical effects were really good.
Yeah, like I kind of like even though it's super underfunded and kind of pulpy and trashy, I kind of like the aesthetic of these movies. I'd love to see a really expensive movie made that looks like a Franzetta painting or something. Probably never happened, but this is sort of the closest you can get, where this is like manly dudes and muscles and kind of vaguely Middle Eastern-y worlds. But the stuff at the start where the evil king awakens the sorcerer and there's the wall of, like, human faces, that's all pretty neat, actually. And the sorcerer also chills out in an evil cave and there's all these, like, spires and glowing red. It's all very, like, again, classic pulpy fantasy. And on an aesthetic level, it's just kind of fun, and there's an ambiguously Asian wish there for some reason. But that sort of aesthetic stuff, I think if you like pulpy things, that can be an appeal to it.
Well, actually, Tom, you mentioned Frank Frazetta, and there was one image I remember now, which reminded me of something from Frank Frazetta. It was at the battle at the end. Talon is in silhouette. He's leaping through the mists, and he's charging towards a rising tide of enemies, and they're all coming in at him. And that was, I legitimately liked that image. And that was pretty much the only good thing I saw from the Sword and the Sorcerer.
Can I talk real quick about things that I absolutely despised about the movie?
We're going to talk about the romance scenes, aren't we?
Oh!
let's not call it romance.
Not so much romance as it is, I don't know what the... It was, you know, I enjoy schlock 80s fantasy as well, but I've never really dug deep. And I always expect at this point TNA, right? That isn't so much the problem. The problem that I have is, like, rape is just straight up, like, a fucking everywhere in this goddamn thing. And you've got the girl who, the brother, is the guy leading the rebellion, you know, like, lead actress. She almost gets raped. The way that she's rescued is seen as a time to do hilarious jokes about the size of the rapist's dick. And then, right after she almost got raped, when she asks for his help...
This is literally the next scene, everybody.
Literally the next scene is that he will not help her without payment of her body. She has to fuck him or else their deal is off. And it's like, dude, you just saw her got raped. How are you any better? You know,
I have a pretty high tolerance for this stuff, but, like, that whole scene, I was physically cringing. I was like, this is bad. This is really bad. And it's so weird.
It felt like all the, you know, because back in high school, I read a shit ton of...
Oh, yeah, it's endemic. Like, there's another one of these movies.
It's not just in fantasy. That whole dynamic is actually the plot of a Marquis de Sade short story, which I read for some reason.
There's a there's a movie, it's a low-budget version of Sword and the Sorcerer, if you can believe that. It's called Deathstalker. I can't recommend in good conscience, but in the first 5 or so minutes of Deathstalker, it's like, you know, there's like sexy fantasy woman that she's about to be raped by goblins.
Of course.
And then so the hero comes and kills all the goblins and then immediately starts having sex with her. This whole thing of like, I saved you from rape, so now you're mine.
Yeah, exactly.
It's everywhere. It's just like,
It's just so gross.
And this is not aged well.
No, it hasn't. And unfortunately, that particular type of love scene seems to be, you know, I know that people go on and on about George R. R. Martin's like rape-tastic scenes and shit like that, but although
it ain't this.
Yeah, it ain't this. And also, I could tell that they did kind of undermine it at one point where in the show, I love it when Tyrion's in the tent with his girl and she says to him, you should have known right away that it was not real because no woman who was about to be raped wants sex from her savior. You know, it's like just not on the table. That's not what they're even thinking about.
This is our hero, everybody.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, there was that. And one more is the fate of poor Elizabeth, Talon's younger sister, by the way. So the little girl that was whisked away at the beginning of the film is made into a sex slave of the king and then dies terribly later on in the film. Her tongue is cut out and she guts herself.
That kind of rubbed me the wrong way, too.
Yeah.
Because she was like a one redeeming element. I was like, oh, she's being a not particularly voluntary prostitute or whatever, but she's like a good character. She's doing her part for the rebellion. And I was like, all right, this is slightly preferable to the previous scenes. And then she just dies miserably. And I'm like, oh, this kind of sucks.
I was just totally put off by the way that they treated women in this movie. And again, I knew that going into it, I was going to be seeing, like, naked women for sure.
Yeah, it's unavoidable in these, which, again, there's this push-pull to me, because I really like a lot of elements of these old schlocky manly men doing fantasy stuff. And, like, even in a, not in a fantasy as in medieval stuff, but fantasy as in, like, whatever you want to jerk it to, I'm like, oh, whatever. But in a narrative like this, just like, this is... Or I thought of, what's the guy in Casablanca? The French fellow? French police officer?
Are you talking about Shocked Shocked?
William, what's the French police officer?
Oh, the Claude Rains character.
Yeah, all right. Yes. The Claude Rains character. You know, in Casablanca, on the edge of that movie, he's basically blackmailing, fleeing European women to have sex with him so that they can get away from the fucking Nazis. And like, that's what I was thinking of during that scene. I was like, our hero is blackmailing this woman into sexual exploitation.
Yep.
Please make it stop.
Yeah, but she was enthusiastic about it by the end.
Of course.
Raw
masculinity.
He won the day at the end. He saved her from a giant fucking snake, right? So.
And the snake was also raping her.
The snake was raping her. The sorcerer out of nowhere is all up on her.
Literally, I mean, if you're a lady in one of these movies or novels, there's just no escape for you. It's really just the worst of the best of the your terrible options. So yeah, that was a thing.
And also her brother.
Not great, everybody.
Her brother at the end when he is like, and now I'll take my reward. And swings away with her. Her brother is watching this and go like, yeah, you get my sister. Good. Go in deep in there.
Well, I mean, that's like that's the 14-year-old logic that is behind these stories, which is, I'm the most awesome dude. I kill all the motherfuckers. I get all the bitches, but I don't care about the bitches too much. So I just, you know, just bang them because I'm so awesome. That is the operational logic of the heroes of these stories. So... yeah, yeah, that's the thing. And it's like every one of these movies that always happens, and I'm like, I'm having a good time, I'm having less of a good time, all right, it's over, back to sort of having a good time. All right, so, yeah, comes with the territory, I guess.
And apparently there was a sequel.
What? No
what,
way,
you didn't see
really?
That? Like, Talon will return in whatever, the Secret Empire or something?
And, no, I did not.
I was looking up...
That was not on my copy.
Neither.
Oh, really? Okay, yeah, it wasn't my copy. Anyway, if you look up The Sword and the Sorcerer on YouTube, one of the recommended videos is for that sequel. The sequel was like, I don't know, like just kickstarted in 2014 or something.
No way, really?
Really?
Really? Huh. I love that somebody in 2014 was like, this movie, you know what it's really lacking? We need to know where this talent character goes.
Like, I mean, it's such a rich world.
totally rich world.
I just looked this up, and of course, the star is none other than Hercules, Kevin Sorbo himself. Cull the Conqueror. Kevin Sorbo is the ultimate 90s TV rent-a-version of all these guys, and now he's still doing it a couple decades later. You know, of course he is.
There you go. Yeah, I'm sure it looks cheap. See, I really, one of these days... And I wish the rebooted Conan movie had been like this versus just throwing a bunch of bullshit together and making a mediocre piece of garbage. But
I was so sad about that.
Yeah, like I really, you know, you look at the poster or something from the 82 Conan movie, or again, some of his friends at art or something, and it's like really aesthetically just awesome. Like everything about it is cool. There's a real like richness to it. I want a high budget movie to take that aesthetic and put it on the screen, but all we get is this. I guess the Conan movie is like the closest, the 82, but, and I guess some of the weird ones, like Crawl or whatever, but someday, guys, I'm gonna fund it, and then there also won't be weird Claude Rains sexual relationships. It'll be slightly less uncomfortable.
I think Conan works for me because it's just this kind of weird mashup of high and low culture. You know, you like quotations of Nietzsche and Vasil Polidori's score. And for long stretches of the film, it's silent.
The 82 Conan is a classic. Yeah. It's like a weird fascistic fantasy, but it's also awesome. The 82 movie, I think, gets these, which is like, it's all atmosphere.
Mm-hmm.
And just sort of these larger-than-life characters and all these things. And it's sort of, yeah. It understands it, what makes it, even though the 82 movie is by no means like a exact adaptation of the source novels or anything, but it sort of gets what is appealing about them, I think, in a way that some of the others don't. And it's less schlocky, it's high schlock, what we're going to call it.
High schlock, I like
high schlock.
High schlock.
Which I can get behind every day of the week.
Well, I mean, to put it one way, it's obviously the work of John Milius, and by all accounts, he was the main inspiration for Walter Sobchak, the character played by John Goodman in The Big Lebowski.
Really? I did not
know. Yeah, no, seriously. Seriously.
Huh.
He's a weird dude, but he has made mostly good movies, or at least interesting ones.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the point is, you know, fascistic is fair and kind of a right-wing element and all that, but it's a perspective.
Yeah.
He has his weird vision that he's throwing into the film, this kind of animalistic ancient fantasy stuff just hurled on it. It's an angle, and it works really well in the film.
Yeah, you talk about the Conan reboot, and it's just, there's nothing there. Nothing.
No soul, kinda, man.
Yeah, there's no soul. Put a weird auteur's soul in my movies. That's a character.
Which, to tie it in a bit, that's something Garzey's has, if nothing else. It's a complete mess, but it's a very personal mess.
That's true. That is very true.
Yeah, you know, actually, I usually have more respect for a movie where you can tell that everybody was, you know, digging deep, you know what I mean? To make it feel, I don't know, true, even if it's kind of schlocky.
Yeah.
It was an awful movie, but it was their awful movie.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we're discussing other movie franchises now, so I think we've run out of things to say about these two movies. So I'm not going to ask if you want to recommend these movies, because I don't think anyone of us can answer yes.
Counterpoint.
Okay. You go, Tom. Sorry.
All right, go,
okay.
Tom.
I would... Okay, so Garzey's Wang, as long as you're watching the dub, I do actually recommend it. Or at least... You don't necessarily need to watch the entire movie, but you should at least watch Little Supercut.
Yes, that was exactly what I was going to say.
So funny. I'm not exaggerating, like, ho-ho, so bad it made me laugh. It really made me cry with laughter, some of the things that come out of these characters' mouths in the dub and the way they're said. It's an unintentional comedy masterpiece. And then Sword and the Sorcerer, again, if you have an inclination towards this genre, it's probably one of the, well, maybe not better, but it's a satisfactory outing in this particular sort of 80s fantasy schlock boom. And if you kind of like have it on in the background and occasionally like the sort of campy images and stuff, I think some people would enjoy it, but you really have to sort of like have some sort of interest in that particular era of fantasy and what it looks like and stuff. So that would be what I would say for both of those.
I would say with the Sword and Sorcerer, frankly, I think you could watch Conan 2 times and get the same satisfaction. You'll be fine. Like, just like if you ever felt like just checking out this movie, go watch Conan again. You'll be okay.
I guess my feeling is Garzey's Wing is absolutely perfect if you know people you like watching bad movies with. If you have any group like that, any connection like that, it's an excellent recommendation because it is hilariously terrible. You know, anyone you'd watch an Ed Wood movie with, watch Garzey's Wing with. That's a top recommendation. You can also watch it by yourself, but it's a lot funnier in company, to be honest. I rewatched it, you know, for this alone, and it wasn't half as fun as, you know, just experiencing it with someone else, because that's just kind of magical, really, because it's so beautifully awful. Sword and the Sorcerer isn't quite as inspired in its badness, but it also does kind of the business. I mean, there are better films, even in terms of the pulp elements. Like, I would say, if you heard the reference to Frank Frazetta and you thought, oh my god, a movie that's like Frank Frazetta, you know, watch, what's it called, Ice and Fire, I think it is? The Ralph Bakshi film, which is literally Frank Frazetta character designs. I really like that one. They heard it's Fire and Ice, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But if, you know, you've watched a lot of these movies and you like 80s fantasy movies and you haven't seen this one and you don't care if it's bad or you want to make fun of it because it's bad, it does that, basically.
It does scratch that itch, I must say.
Well, I'm going to repeat my opinion of Fist of the North Star for Garzey's Wing. If you are high or if you're loaded, it's actually pretty hilarious. But I would say do not specifically seek it out for itself and expect something good. And if you just want to laugh at it, yeah, look for that supercut on YouTube. For Sword and the Sorcerer, it's actually the kind of movie I would have watched in high school at like 1:30 in the morning on cable. And if I had watched it that way, I might have appreciated it. But the way I watch it, which is to actually find a copy, sit down, and watch nothing but it for 2 hours, that is like the complete wrong way to watch it. Because I was like, oh my god, this is so awful. Who the hell thought of this? I don't want to watch this, but I have to watch it.
That is fair.
I still enjoy that you were thinking of other fight scenes during the movie.
Oh my god. It's very flashed through my mind. Every single time they were fighting, I was like, oh, that's kind of like that one Jackie Chan movie. Or...
well... with that, William, lead us out.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to do a long, improbable think here. Yeah, this is going to be a hard one to mention Hitchcock. He never really did fantasy. But, but he did do Torn, let's say Topaz, because I have a fondness for Topaz, but it's kind of a mess, and people didn't like it. And in a way, that's his Garzey's Wing. That's as close as he gets. That's my connection. It's extremely forced, the weakest connection I've made yet. But moving away from Hitchcock, next time we'll be looking at World War I, specifically World War I and 2017. Because already this year there have been 2 works, one of anime and one non-anime, that dealt with the war in a fantasy context. One is the saga of Tanya the Evil, or Yojo Senki, the anime series that aired in winter. And the other one is the film Wonder Woman, which transposes the character originally created in World War II to a World War I setting. Yeah.
Awesome, awesome. I look forward to this. I will give the spiel. If you enjoyed this podcast, you can find us at podcastleinthesky@wordpress.com. And sometimes we put up other content aside from the casts, although... you know, it's like a rare and delicate flower when it happens. Cactus blooming in the rain. You can also find us on Twitter at Flying Podcastle. And you guys are actually pretty prolific with the Twitters. I watch you guys talk. If you like what you hear, leave a review on iTunes, and you can also find us on Stitcher.
Okay.
See you next time.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. Yeehaw.
Yay.
So long.
Bye.
Duff Wiedersehen.